Good afternoon, and thank you for those of you who decided to come back from break to catch the last session of the meeting. Now, no disrespect to the other presenters, but according to my mother, this is her favorite part of the annual meeting program. So we've tried to do a couple things different this year to kind of spice up the government relations portion of the meeting. We've got the obligatory legislative video that we've got, and this year we did something different. Instead of having one or two legislators come up and try to give us some video footage, we contacted about 10 different legislators and did, again, something that some people thought couldn't be done. We asked them to give us a 1 minute or less overview of what's going on up in D.C. So with that, we're going to play that video, and you'll have about 10 legislators, less than a minute each.
Well, welcome to Bismarck, and thank you to the Basin Electric Power Co-op for inviting me to share a few words. Year-round, the folks in this room work day in and day out to provide quality, affordable energy to Montana and rural communities across this country. You keep our lights on and help make our communities brighter. And Montana plays a big role in the national energy conversation. Montana leads the nation in recoverable coal deposits. We're the fifth largest producer of hydropower in the nation, and we also have oil, natural gas, wind, and solar. You see, Montana's diverse energy portfolio helps create good-paying jobs and helps lead our nation to be energy independent, and more importantly, will help our nation secure global energy dominance. As your United States Senator in Montana, I'll continue to fight to ensure our communities remain bright and organizations like yours have the support that you need to do just that. Thanks again for all that you do.
I care about rural infrastructure, and I always have. And as much as anybody else in this country, Basin Electric is making the kind of investments in rural infrastructure that this country needs. You know, out of 435 members of the U.S. House, there are only 45, if you can believe it, that represent districts that are mostly rural in population. Of course, I'm one of them. And that means people like myself need to work every single day, not only to represent the Constitution or our state, but rural America. Thank you for what you're doing and making these rural communities, these rural families, these rural businesses stronger and better. We're going to keep trying to do the same thing out here in Congress. A big part of that is going to be getting USMCA passed. A big part of that is going to make sure that we've got a farm safety net that takes care of our farmers and ranchers when times are tough. A big part of that is going to make sure that we've got a regulatory regime that doesn't do too much to try to control the economy and doesn't treat small operators or rural areas any worse than they have to. That's the fight we're going to keep doing. Thank you for your part in it. Have a great meeting.
Hello, everyone. This is Joni Ernst, the junior senator from the great state of Iowa. I'm sorry I can't be with you all for this year's annual meeting, but I'm pleased to be able to share a few words. I especially want to send a warm hello and welcome to all the members from Iowa who made the trip. It's an honor to serve on your behalf in Congress. As you all know, co-ops play a fundamental and critical role for our communities, local business, and families in Iowa and across the nation. I'm proud to support all of your good work. You all may be familiar with one of the key bipartisan bills I'm currently working on, called the Revitalizing Underdeveloped Rural Areas and Lands, or RURAL Act. This legislation, which continues to grow support with now 39 co-sponsors of both parties, would help provide predictability for co-ops, ensuring that they retain their tax-exempt status when they receive grants for vital services such as expanding broadband and enhancing our electrical grid. These efforts are essential in ensuring our communities, especially in rural areas, can be successful and can thrive.
Hello, and welcome to Bismarck. All due respect to my friends in the South, East, and West, but you picked the best state for your annual meeting. I was glad to see some of you during your recent trip to DC. We talked about the importance of affordability and reliability of electric markets. As we prepare for another North Dakota winter, reliability of our grid is not a luxury, but an absolute necessity. We all know the energy landscape has changed a lot in the last few decades. The development of renewable energy resources such as wind and solar and open access requirements help lay the foundation for the competitive markets we have right now. But the regulation that enabled these advances needs to be updated. We need to provide states with greater flexibility so they can accommodate their unique circumstances. We need to address issues related to gaming under the 1 mile rule, and we need to change the threshold for non-discriminatory access. These reforms will modernize the markets and help ensure another 40 years of affordable and reliable power. That's something we can all get behind. Thank you for your advocacy and for all you do year-round to make sure that the lights stay on. Have a great conference and welcome to North Dakota.
Thank you for inviting me to say a few words during Basin Electric Power Cooperative's annual meeting. One of my priorities in the Senate is to ensure that Americans have access to affordable and reliable electricity. And that means ensuring Wyoming is able to continue its production of coal and natural gas. As the third largest energy producing state and the top state for coal production, Wyoming helps power electric co-ops all across the nation. Under the previous administration, Wyoming's energy industry faced unprecedented attacks that are still harming the coal industry today. I'm proud to be working with the Trump administration to repeal those harmful rules and regulations to ensure that your members have access to affordable and reliable energy. I look forward to working with the electric cooperatives to ensure your success for years to come.
Electric and telephone cooperatives are an essential part of ensuring rural communities have the infrastructure and services for everyday needs. In particular, electric and telephone cooperatives are vital in solving the issue of the last mile by ensuring electricity in hard-to-reach areas. But as everyone here knows, access to federal and state grants are essential for you all to do your jobs. That's why I'm proud to have signed on to the Rural Act, the Revitalizing Underdeveloped Rural Areas and Lands Act, which would exempt disaster relief grants from the income that is considered for the 85-15 split. Again, thank you for all that you do to power our communities, and know that I'm doing everything I can in Congress to support you.
Hi, it's Jim Hagedorn, Congressman from Minnesota's 1st District, which is most of southern Minnesota. And I'd like to thank my friends with Basin Electric for all that you do to produce and deliver power to our rural residents. You help maintain our quality of life and you keep the cost of living down, and that's very important. Over this first year in Congress, I've gotten to know some of your members and your executives, and they've impressed upon me a few things. One is that we do need a fix in that tax bill from a couple years ago to make sure that you're not going to have to pay taxes on certain disaster payments that you might receive. We're on that bill and we support you. We also want to make sure that we don't go ahead and do something. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. So why would we go out and sell these power marketing administrations, especially the one there with Southwest Power? It doesn't make a lot of sense. And I don't support that. I don't think that's a policy that we need to go down. But I would like, I've heard a lot about your project there with coal gasification, carbon capture. Like to make a stop up there and visit and tour the plant and see what's going on firsthand. And I look forward to that in the near future. I'm Jim Hagedorn. Thanks for watching.
I want to start by thanking you all for what you do. As many of you know, my dad was a lineman for the Rural Electric, and like many in North Dakota, I grew up with a personal appreciation for the jobs that you support and the work you do to provide affordable, reliable, I stress reliable, energy for families back home. So thanks for what you're doing. Whether you're from New Mexico or Minnesota, North Dakota, or Wyoming, or any place in between, we love you and appreciate what you're doing. In August, I sent a letter to the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission expressing my continued concern over our nation's grid reliability and resilience. Consumers currently experience relatively stable service, but the system has become unnecessarily complex with less margin for error. As we've seen from multiple extreme heat and cold events, smaller and smaller reserve margins coupled with intermittent generating resources and more reliance on natural gas are straining the system when people need it most. We have to be bold in our approach and make the necessary reforms to prioritize reliable baseload generation.
The Senate is also making progress on my retirement security legislation that will make a positive difference for employers and employees alike. Keeping on top of government bureaucracy through oversight is always a priority. You may remember when FEMA tried to impose even more government burdens on rural electric cooperatives a few years ago when we had natural disasters. I led our delegation in pushing back. So I look forward to more work alongside you folks to keep rural America strong and to keep energy flowing for our very important agricultural industry.
Affordable and reliable energy is essential to our quality of life and helps support a growing economy. Basin Electric and its member cooperatives provide this critical service across 9 states, including North Dakota. At the same time, you continue to invest in next generation technologies that will help ensure we can continue to rely on all of our nation's energy resources. As a member of the Senate committees that oversee energy, natural resources, and appropriations, I'm working to bolster your efforts and support a true path forward for coal and other traditional energy sources. To this end, I helped secure funding in recent fiscal years to advance the development of innovative energy technologies like the Alum Cycle and Project Tundra. I also continue my efforts to extend the refined coal tax credit and modernize the 45Q and 48A tax credits, which will help make CCUS projects more commercially viable. Thank you again for the invitation and your ongoing contributions to our state and nation. Best wishes for an enjoyable and productive meeting.
All kidding aside, it's a great testament to the folks in this room that when we ask favors of the senators and representatives, that they'll take the time out of their schedule to do something like this and provide us with a video. The only way this happens is, again, through that relationship that you have with the legislators when we go there. Base Electric can go so far, but it's your relationship that makes it happen. So the next time you get a chance to see your senator or representative, please take the time to thank them for putting together a few comments for us. And also let me know or someone in government relations staff if this is a format you think is worthwhile, or whether you'd like to have more in-depth talk and information from the senators and representatives. The other things I want to go through are a little bit is just to talk about what we're working on the federal level, and then to move a little bit away from the normal talk and talk about what we see as policy drivers coming forward at us in the future. What we're seeing is some things that are going more to the distribution co-op level that you're going to see, we think, more of in the future. Starting on the federal issues, let's talk about the Section 45 tax credit. Now, Section 45 is simply a section in the Internal Revenue Service Tax Code that offers federal tax credits for either sequestering or using CO2 for enhanced oil recovery. Section 45 has been around for quite a while. What has happened recently, though, is they made changes in it in 2018 to make it a higher tax incentive and make it more usable. So it's something that a lot of co-ops, a lot of industries are looking at to take advantage of. The couple of changes that were made beside increasing the level of the tax credit was that they allowed it to run for a set period. So if you use a section, if you have a project that works for Section 45, it's a 12-year tax credit that you become available for. But the construction has to start by January 1st of 2024. Now, getting the legislation passed is only part of the job. After that is passed, then the IRS has to develop rules on how that law will be implemented. And so we're looking at a couple of different things that we want to make sure get into that rule. Now, the rule itself was passed back in 2018, but we're still here in this time waiting for those implementation rules to be developed. So we're looking forward to getting something done. The latest we've heard is that we may see some partial rules come out around Thanksgiving time or by the end of the year. The areas that we want to see focused on from the IRS is that the way the rule or the way the law was passed, it says when carbon capture equipment is installed on a facility, your 12-year clock starts. Our position is that just because you capture it at the facility doesn't mean it's sequestered to use in EOR. So you should look at a full project before that clock starts. When it's captured, when it's transported, and when it's either sequestered or used for EOR, that should start the 12-year clock. This is especially important if we want to do any kind of project with Dakota Gas. Because with Dakota Gas, the process itself creates the CO2 stream. So that's where we want to get that change in definitions so that our clock didn't start in February of 2018. It'll start when the project is done. Dakota Gas is not the only industry or only project that that would apply to. Ethanol plants have the same situation. Their process creates a pure stream of CO2. So their equipment is already there. So we have some allies as we look forward to getting that change done. The other thing that we're looking at is the start date. If some of it are looking at, by the time you do the engineering, if we get the rules put together, then to do the engineering, align the stakeholders that we want to make this work, if you look at a 2024 start date, it may get a little bit tight going forward. A couple projects that we're looking at, as I referred to, a potential project that we could use some of the CO2 that comes off of DGC. The other project, it would be the Dry Fork Station, where you look at what we're capturing some CO2 with the ITC project, and potentially for Dry Fork itself. If we get some technology that works where we can put that on the Dry Fork Station, then that 2024 start date could get to be tight for us. As we've worked on this project, we've sent comments to the IRS. We were able to get the governors from Wyoming and North Dakota to send letters to the IRS. We've got ag and ethanol groups supporting our position, and we've got the oil and gas industry supporting our position as well. We've also reached out to the Senate, provided a letter for them to the IRS. That letter was signed for our local senators with Senator Barrasso from Wyoming, Senator Daines from Montana, and Senators Hovind and Kramer from North Dakota. The other rule that we're working on on the federal side is the ACE rule, or the Affordable Clean Energy Act. Now, as we hoped before, we hoped that this rule would have been passed and implemented end of 2018, maybe the beginning of 2019. It did finally go into effect in September of 2019. And again, as with the other project, the work started once the legislation got passed. The one good thing that it does repeal and replace the Clean Power Plan, which we had serious problems with. And with the new ACE rule, it develops a standard of performance for individual plants. And that's where we wanted the focus to be, was on the individual facility. What EPA did is they said, how can we make a generation plant as clean and efficient as possible, which reduces the amount of CO2 it puts out in the air? And they came up with 7 technologies or practices that make your plant clean and efficient. Those 7 technologies are referred to as a standard of performance. And when you look at base electric facilities, we have most, if not all, of these technologies on our plans. So we're sitting in good shape with the ACE rule. The final thing is that the state has 3 years to put together a plan to submit to the EPA. Now again, getting the rule passed, if you look at the Clean Power Plan, once that got passed, there were groups that came out against it. We were part of that side. Now the roles have been reversed with the ACE rule. The ACE rule was passed, and the other folks had their chance to file against the ACE rule, and that deadline ended October 7th of 2019. The opposition to the ACE rule came in from the American Lung Association, the American Public Health Association, 22 states, several cities, and several other environmental groups. On those supporting EPA's decision were Basin Electric and also the state of North Dakota locally. Now, good news, because as we get to the point where the rule was passed and it moves into the court system, the DC Circuit Court has officially dismissed all challenges to the Clean Power Plan, so the Clean Power Plan is officially dead. That will not come back. The next steps for consideration of the ACE rule, it'll go to the DC Circuit Court of Appeals, but I think it's very likely that the ACE rule will end up at the Supreme Court. I want to move away from legislation and regulation and talk about some of the things that we're going to see happening going forward as related to policy that we maybe plan on, but a lot of things that we don't normally see. When we look at things like the federal regulatory uncertainty, that's fine. We see that happen all the time. But we've got the federal actions taking place. We have got state actions taking place, some that are normal, some that aren't expected. But then we get into the new area of, if you want to call it activism or help, you're getting into the businesses taking a more active role in energy development and energy policy, and you're seeing activist groups become more active in energy policy and energy development. But the end result of this is the same as we've seen before. We are still going to be working in a carbon-constrained or a carbon-managed future. That part is not going to change. If we take them one at a time, looking at the federal action, and we've seen the bookend of it already. We saw the Obama administration come through with the Clean Power Plan that was very restrictive, told you what plants you could run, what you could not run, what you could build, what you could not build. Now we have the Trump administration with pretty much a 180 look saying, we've got the ACE rule, where it says we're going to focus on the facility, focus on technologies that are out there that are commercially available and affordable. But you can just bet on it that if we see a change in administration, we're going to swing back the other way, and this is just going to be the norm that we're going to operate into. Every time there's going to be an administration change, we're going to see a shift back and forth, and as Basin Electric, we're going to have to walk the middle line on this stuff to be prepared for either activity taking place. Now, as we get into the state side of it, we're seeing a new push that's been coming on. The map you see in front of you is highlight states that either by executive order or by legislative mandate have decided that they want to have a 100% clean energy standard at some point in the future. Now, those years vary. Some of them are as early as 2032. Most of them, the latest part they go is 2050. But all of them are looking at a clean energy standard. And keep in mind, it's going to be very important to listen to the words that are being said here, because a clean energy standard is going to be wind, solar, in some cases hydro, in some cases nuclear, and in some cases carbon capture with coal facilities. But they take a different stroke at it in a different state. But we've got 14 states right now that have that either proposed as a goal, passed by the legislature, or enacted by their governors by executive order. And we think this will continue as we move forward. The last part I want to get to, or I guess that's the third part I want to get into, is individual businesses taking more of a role in what we do with generation. A lot of things that we see happening, especially more on the areas where you've got large companies coming in, and those large companies could be the Amazon, the Googles, the Facebooks, where they come in. We've had a specific example out towards on the eastern part of the United States where the, I believe it was Google or Facebook, came in with a very large project. They went to the utility and said, okay, here's the area we're going to put this project in. We want you to serve it. Utility said, that's great. So they went and put together a power resource plan to meet that load, took it to their regulator, the Public Service Commission, only to have the exact load they're trying to serve come into the Public Service Commission and oppose their plan, saying you're not doing enough renewables, you're not doing enough battery storage, you need to change that. So you've got that happening. You've also got the companies going to utilities on their own saying, we want you to get out of coal, we want you to get out of natural gas, we want you to go more renewables. So individual businesses becoming more engaged at the utility level and at the regulatory level. In some cases, they're demanding clean energy. In some cases, they're demanding renewable energy. And you've also got the case where you've got the shareholders going to the company. So they're getting pressure from their shareholders to take a stand more on climate change, more on energy generation. So you'll see some of them going for clean energy, some of them going for the renewable energy side of it. When you talk about the renewable energy side of it, you're also seeing companies band together to form coalitions. One of these groups is called RE100, and this RE100 is talking about 100% renewable energy, not clean, renewable. The members of this RE100 are Facebook, Walmart, General Motors, Goldman Sachs, Google, Starbucks, and most major financial institutions such as the Bank of America. Now, when you get into renewables, you're going to get into a different conversation from a utility standpoint. Now, everyone, I would think most people in this room understand that when you look at what activists or environmentalists would call a utility that gets it, they will talk about Xcel Energy. They're saying Xcel Energy is a utility that knows what the consumers want and where to go. The Xcel Energy has made it depending on who you talk to, a goal or an aspiration to have 100% clean energy by 2050. But they are the ones that are seen as the utilities leading the way down the renewable task force. So what came as an interest to me when I found a presentation that Xcel Energy had made to the Midwest Governors Association earlier this year. And in that presentation to the Midwest Governors, they talked about what it would take to get this country to a 100% renewable situation. So one of the things that they went to is they said, if you want 100% renewable energy in this country, you will have to overbuild the transmission grid by 8 times. Also, you hear a lot about batteries and storage. They said, if you want to have battery storage to have 100% renewables in this country, you will need 6 to 16 weeks worth of battery storage. Now, I know in conversations we've had, we've wondered how much battery storage do you really need. We never came up with a timeline this long. And if you look at the current battery technology that's out there right now, current battery technology is in the 4-hour range, nowhere near the 6 or 16 week range. So if you're going to get to that point, it will cost you trillions of dollars to get there. Again, this is Xcel Energy talking about what they needed to do. The last thing they talked about was what kind of costs are you going to look at? The chart in front of you is a study done by the California Independent System Operator. Now, CalISO is just like MISO and just like SPP, but they just handle the California area. When they looked at it, they said, when you look at your current power right now, you're approximately in the $50 per megawatt hour or the 5 cent per kilowatt hour range. If you get 50% renewable energy, that cost does not change very much. You're still in that $50 per megawatt hour or 50 cent range. You move above 50% and get to the 80%, all of a sudden your costs are going to jump from $50 to over $400, so in the 40 cent per kilowatt hour range. If you actually get to 100, you will be looking at a $1,612 per megawatt hour range, or if my calculations are right, $1.60 per kilowatt hour to get to that point. So I think there can be a sweet spot between renewable energy and the fossil energy backup that we need for reliability, but keep the costs where we need to go. But for those folks that are going down the road of 100% renewable, I think there's some serious questions that need to be asked. The last thing I want to get into is what we're seeing as more of an activist role that are coming in. And the activist role can be seen as, depending on the side you're on, as helpers or hindrances to the cooperative that you see. We've put together a chart that kind of encompasses a lot of the activist groups that we've seen operating in the base electric service area or within the region. And I want to highlight a couple of those groups just to give you an idea of kind of what they're offering, where they're headed, what they want to accomplish. And now I'm providing this really as information only. I don't want to say these companies are good, bad, or indifferent, just that they're out there, that if they may contact you, or else you're going to see reports written by these companies. So just kind of be aware of what the companies are and what they're working on. The first one I'll take is at the top, Guzman Energy. We've heard a lot of talk about Guzman Energy. They are an energy company, they call themselves. They are either owned or financed by investment bankers or investment banks or investment funds. Their push is to talk about providing renewable energy to co-ops and to other utilities. They're offering lower prices, looking at comparing co-op rates versus market rates. At this point, they're looking at energy only. They have, from what I was told, they have no plans to either build their own generation. They will contract for the generation that's out there. As I said, their emphasis is on renewables, but they also come in and push against either the co-op model or the G&T and co-op relationship that's out there as part of the process that they go through. They're offering 10-year contracts for their energy that they do. When you ask them about planning, scheduling, or ancillary services, you don't get a real clear answer on where that comes from, whether they'll do it, the developer does it, or whether you'll have to find some place to do that. Another group we want to highlight is the We Own It group. Now, We Own It started out as a co-op governance organization, and there's nothing bad we can say about wanting good governance within our co-ops, from the members themselves to the board directors at all. We all want good governance to be taking place. This group sprouted up from areas and times when you didn't see that happening. If you go back to the Perdinala situation in Texas, where you had the board and the executive team not following the co-op principles and doing things that weren't right, that's where this group kind of got started. In talking with people from We Own It, they're saying that the co-ops don't do enough to gather and develop leadership within the membership for people that don't want to run to the board. So what We Own It group will do, for they will find people that want to run for the board, they will provide training for these folks to run for the board. In fact, they run a 3-month program and they will pay a per diem to the people who want to learn between $500 and $1,000 for a month for 3 months to learn how to run a campaign for the board. Then they will also help finance that campaign to be a board director. So in their mind, they are filling a need that the co-ops are not doing to provide governance. And again, we have no problem with that type of situation. What we have seen lately is the We Own It folks are also now moving into a renewable or clean energy advocacy role as part of an addition to their governance role. So the thing that may raise some eyebrows is if you've got a group that is paying for training, paying to finance campaigns, but also having them carry an agenda that may or may not be what the members want. So another group to be aware of. The last group I want to highlight is the Rocky Mountain Institute. This is also an electric utility advocacy group. Their stated goal is to transform the U.S. grid from big fossil fuel plants to large-scale renewables and distributed solutions. They say that they provide a market-based approach and are a very analytical group, providing reports and analysis of grid and generation. They have done reports on potential savings using renewable energy. We saw this happen. They did one on Tri-State. They also have done one or participated in one for Alliant Energy in Iowa. And so you'll see these reports come out that may be signed by one or more of these people or these groups. We have seen reports come out talking about Tri-State, also talking about Basin, and they had the We Own It sponsored it, we had the CURE group sponsor it, Rocky Mountain sponsored it, and the Center for Rural Affairs sponsored it. So these groups are coming together, putting these reports together. Of course, we're a little bit biased. We think that some of their factors that they use in developing the reports may not be completely accurate. They stand behind their reports when they come forward with. So what do these groups have in common? Normally, they're smaller groups. We haven't seen it where there's a large movement from the membership. It's small, very vocal groups. They've got a common anti-carbon ideology going for renewables and clean energy. Some things that they do that some will do is they'll create questions or doubt about the co-op model, about the direction of the co-op, about the decision-making of the co-op, about the board directors of the co-op, and things like that. So there's other different messages mixed in. So from our perspective, what are the things that you should be aware of if you're talking with these groups or looking at these reports is, number one, think about ask where the reliability comes from. You know, as we've heard before, they'll talk about renewables and battery storage, which we, from our understanding, it isn't available yet. So ask these groups, where does the reliability come from? Does it come from fossil fuels? Is it coal, is it natural gas? Does it come from nuclear? Does it come from batteries? And if so, what is all this change going to cost? Me as a co-op, me as a consumer on there. And then who's going to cover the planning side? I think we saw a chart earlier on when you looked at all the services that are within your rates right now from Basin Electric. So ask where those services are coming on so that you know what you're walking into. From a Basin Electric position, we're going to look at things that we want to do going forward. Basin Electric, there's two things here. We're always going to support technology that's going to reduce our carbon footprint, but we're going to do it ensuring that you've got the reliable power that you need, and we're going to do our best to keep that power as affordable as possible. We're going to continue research into how to use all electricity better, alternative ways to generate electricity with all fuels. We're going to continue things like our research into the integrated test center, the dry fork station, and CarbonSafe, how to handle carbon better. And we're also going to support common sense regulations on CO2, such as the ACE rule. The last thing I want to close out with is talk about tours. Tours, we are our best selling point, our best education tool that we have. We do a great job, you guys do a great job of bringing your members up here to tour our facilities. We appreciate those opportunities to do that. Along with that, the Government Relations Force and others look at how can we bring in legislators and regulators, both on the state side and federal side, to give them a tour and show them how things actually work, how we do business. This year, we were lucky enough to do several things. We were able to bring some Minnesota regulators and legislators in. We were also able to bring South Dakota legislators in. And one thing that we did this year that was different is we reached out to NRECA, and specifically to their lobbying group. Their lobbying group, like a lot of other groups, has gone through a lot of change, so they had a lot of new folks in there that did not have a good understanding of coal-based generation or basin electric. So we were able to bring them out there and give them a tour. And what I want you to do is we got a short video that we took of these folks kind of at the end of their tour to say, what did you think of the tour? What did you learn? And I'll leave you with that. Thank you very much.
As a membership organization, we need to be close to all our members, to communicate closely with all of our members so that we understand how policy decisions that we help to shape impact the member at the end of the line.
My great-grandfather is Arthur Jones, Art Jones, and he was the first board president of Basin Electric. So not only did I grow up on co-op lines, electric and telco, but I grew up understanding that great-grandpa had something big to do with the electric cooperatives in my area. And so it has been a joy coming from a small town of 1,100, living in Washington, D.C., getting to work on behalf of where I came from.
I think the thing that made a huge impression on me was just the amount of capital involved. It's significant sums of money put into these systems, this infrastructure.
It was just how big, how expansive, how diverse, the several different fertilizers or chemicals.
And it's also a testament to your member consumers who are willing to invest their hard-earned money into the system.
Certainly for this area specifically, sort of different challenges than so many other parts of rural America that aren't facing huge load increases and economic development booms, but are dealing with challenges going the other way.
I think we take for granted when we turn on the light switch at home and there's always electricity there, the lights always come on. And to experience, I had no idea all this takes place up here, and to experience from taking a scoop of coal out of the ground and the process that it goes through to get that to the point where you at home are able to just flip a switch and things just work, that's incredible. And the amount of people that it takes to make that happen is also amazing, and they do a fantastic job. So very impressed, very thankful for the opportunity. I learned a ton.
I think the number one thing is the byproducts that are being produced in addition to energy. Secondly, I thought it was really good to hear that the mining operation and the generating plants are working together very well. And I thought that was really good. And then the third thing is that they acknowledge, the power plants acknowledge that every once in a while the environment changes, and they're working and expecting that, the clean up the environment, et cetera. I thought that was very impressive.
We just got done being at the drag line there, and it was awesome. I mean, just the sheer volume and what they do there, and watching that operator sit there and visit with you and run that big old boom and loader and just pick stuff up and visit with you. I mean, and he made it look so easy, and he was trying to act like it was easy, but it had to take a lot of training to be that good at it.
It doesn't matter how many locations you've been on or what you've seen. Every time you come out to a coal mine or a power generation plant, you are blown away by the size and scale of the facility. And what I appreciated about today were, number one, people's sincerity, and number two, their love of their jobs. You can tell that people are really, really proud of the good work being done here, and I just enjoyed it so much. Thank you.
My big takeaway from this tour today was appreciating everything that goes into flipping the switch at my house. It's just amazing what it takes, and I will never forget the information that I got today that allows me to appreciate it more when I flip that switch.
Well, first impression is just wow, how large a facility this is. And when you think about it, how it's all integrated, you have the coal mines that feed the power plant and feed the syngas plant here, and it's just amazing to see it all in one spot. Integrated Test Center. Oh, it's a huge resource. And matter of fact, when I was driving up to that plant, I thought it was on shutdown. Okay, there was no noise coming out of it. There was no emissions coming out of it. So I took a picture, and I use that now when I talk to people around the country. I said, this is the real story of what coal is, where you don't see any emissions coming out of it. There's not even steam. It's the type of technology, leading edge technology, and it's really an answer to the misinformation that's out there about the coal industry. I don't think anybody, you know, driving over the hill expects to see how big it is, number one. And I knew some of the history behind it because DOE had its piece in the very early beginning. But what Basin has done with it in the past 20 years is amazing.